Want to trust God? You have to have a firm belief in Him. And the only way you can have a firm belief in Him is by knowing Him. Daniel chapter 10, Daniel chapter 11, verse 32b. Daniel 11, 32b says, they that know their God, they shall be strong and they shall do exploits. Shall be strong and they shall do exploits. It is in knowing God, it is knowing that God can heal all manner of sickness and disease, that you can trust Him with it. In knowing God that God can make you rich, that you can trust Him with it. It's in knowing God that God can lift up a beggar from the dunghill and set among prisons, that you can trust Him with it. In knowing God that Proverbs 21 verse 1 says, the hearts of kings are in the hand of God. It is God that directs the heart of man. That when a woman wants to talk to the husband, he says, I surrender the heart of that man into you, into your hand. As I talk to him, Lord, direct his heart to favor me. And you say, hello, sweetheart. This is so thing. She said, hey, you just keep quiet. You will call me back and say, I will. Praise the Lord. You get what I'm saying? It is that when you are going for any presentation, any board meeting, any form of presentation, you subject their heart, all their hearts, the heart of that professor, all of their hearts into the hand of God and say, Father, you are the one that controls the streams of water, control the heart of this, that. And when you go there, you sit before them. And you know that He's controlling their heart for you. Because you know Him that He said the heart of kings are in His hand. So if knowing God is what will enable you to trust Him, then what are you supposed to do? Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing and by hearing the word of God. It means that you should always be in a place where you hear more of God's word than where you hear more of the issues. And when this COVID-19 issue started, the only thing they say, they even got confused. They're the one that said, no, it's not airborne disease. They're the one that later can say, okay, you can begin to wear masks. They started, did you not understand that? Sometimes everyone wanted to almost come with the theory that if mosquito bites you, bite the other person, the COVID-19 will come. If you touch, it became something else. And the whole world was shaking. Because that's all we are hearing. I shut down. Lord, what do you say? I saw plagues that even God has broken into the world so many times. How they ceased. How they disappeared. How He marked some with His blood and didn't touch them, touched the other. I started trusting God on it and throw my weight on God. Don't I start to tell you that, oh, nothing will happen, come to church. COVID-19 see you anywhere, we run. You carry in you the mark of Christ. You are shielded under the shadow of the Almighty. Look, everywhere you are living, the shadow of the Almighty is there. You are His own. You belong to even that place you are walking, where you are doing your business. You are His own. So faith comes by hearing and by hearing the word of God. Learn to open the YouTube and hear God's word concerning anything that has to do with your life. Just keep on soaking your spirit with that. Your trust for Him will be stronger. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, if knowing God is what makes us trust for Him strong, study thyself approved. 2 Timothy 2:15. Study thyself approved, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Learn to study God's word. The Bible says, I don't know how to study. Just take the Bible like this. Open it this way. Any word that opens before you is God's word.
Yes.
Read it. Some say, Pastor, anytime I want to read the word of God, I feel sleepy. Don't mind. It's good. He giveth his beloved sleep. While you are reading it, sleep. Put your head on it. It's His word. It's a medicine to your soul. The prophet said, I ate His word and it was honey to my mouth. Sleep on it. Don't mind. But cultivate this habit of always wanting to study His word. Cultivate that habit. When you start to do that, the next thing you know is that you are willing. God loves willing hearts. God never looks for a perfect heart. He loves willing hearts. God loves people that are teaching, that are willing. And there's a saying that where there's a will, there's a way. So you start to create ways for people who are willing. When you see that, oh, this is my daughter, this is my son, love to study my word. But anytime he's studying God, the day work is weak, he falls on it, he's sleeping. You know what he begins to do? You need to help your spirit man for those few times to begin to grow. Once in a while, when you are reading it and you force one scripture, one verse, or one word, just one word. You don't need too much, just one word will flow into your spirit man that will activate you. You start to go from one word to a phrase, to a sentence, to a verse, to each other. That's how it is. Hallelujah. Amen. Trust God. Study His word. Joshua 1:8 says, this book of the law shall not depart from my mouth. I should learn to talk about it. And I will meditate on it day and night. Doesn't end there. And I will observe to do what is written in it. Many people, they confess it, they meditate on it, but they don't observe what to do. Let me just use one case study and I close. Matthew 14:28-31. The story of Peter. I tell you that when you practice God's word, you begin to do exploit. They that know their God, they shall first be strong. Daniel 11:32b, and they shall then what do exploit. Matthew 14, you see your bulletin 28-31. And Peter answered him, there was a great storm. The Bible says a boisterous storm. The winds were heavy. He was taking the Titanic ship up and down. He could see everything flying everywhere. And suddenly, they saw a man walking on it. God is looking for somebody who will display his splendor, who will display his glory. Those things you are thinking are so great problems, God wants to work on them, wants to make it anointing. Matthew 18, he said, whatever you rubbish on earth, you will rubbish.
Hallelujah.
They were seen as storm. He was seen as steps. He was walking on it. They were crying for their life. Suddenly they saw Jesus walking on the water. They were confused. Who is this walking on this kind of storm? And in verse 28, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. Come, like people want to do expert. You want to come? Come. And when Peter was come down from the ship, he walked. They say he was about to walk. He actually walked on the water to go to Jesus. There's a starting issue came. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. I told you, focus. He will give perfect peace to only those whose mind stayed on him. One whose mind is stayed on the boisterous wind. Many of us are always distracted, wanting to begin to look at the problem. No. He said, forget the problem. No matter how boisterous it is, put your mind on me. The very time that lens was on the paper, under that sun, the paper started burning, isn't it? Concentrated. Focus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sing. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And then Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, therefore did thou doubt. People who doubt are people who take their mind away from God. They don't trust God fully. They take their mind into the issue. You need to magnify God, friends. Over whatever issue you're going through, put your mind on him. Put your focus on him. Talk more about what you know he can do than what the thing can do against you. Do you understand what I'm saying? One of the people that is not too easy to preach healings to are science students. They've gone through the compound medical school, they have seen all the germs and everything, they see how it works. We are talking to them, they can't comprehend it. Because why? They know too much about those science, issues. And they can't comprehend how God can do it. Instead of them to put more, knowing more of God, they know too much. They know the origin of the virus. They know the composition of the virus. They know the destructive things the virus can do. They know its incubation period. They know everything. They don't know the one whose word is quick, with power, which is sharper than any two-edged sword, who can pierce and divide asunder both spirit and soul, and can pierce into marrows. They don't know. Tell somebody, put your mind on him. Peter's mind initially was on him. He was looking at Jesus. But suddenly, he turned. I close your eyes from the boisterous winds.
Amen.
And lift your face to him.
Amen.
There's somebody hearing the sound of my voice. There's an investment you want to do, but you have been putting your heart away from. You have been looking at the boisterous storm around you. Something is urging you to go into that investment. Something is pushing you to do it, but you are looking too much. There's a scripture in the book of Ecclesiastes. It says, anyone who look out, who will be observing whether rain will fall, will not go out, will not sow. You know that scripture in the book of Ecclesiastes? He said, the lazy man will look and say, there's a lion out there, won't go out. No! Put your trust in Jesus. That investment, God said, is going to bring a big, huge turnaround for you.
Amen.
Don't be afraid. Trust God with it. Tell somebody, put your mind on it. Trust God. I close with the last scripture in the book of Exodus chapter 4. See one man, there are three people in Israel, and they come out of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation that the Jews don't play with. Oh, thank God for the life of Abraham. Great. The second one is Moses. God had to bury Moses himself, or else they would turn Moses to their God. The dead body of Moses, the bone of Moses would become a God to Israel. So God had to conceal his body for the way they trust and fear Moses. Whereas it was God that was at work through his life. Let's see what brought Moses to that level. Exodus 4, verse 2 to 4. And the Lord said unto him, what is that that is in thy hand? And he said, a rod. Go on. And he said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground. And it became a serpent. And Moses fled from before him. He showed that even as old as those years passed, people fear snake. He was saying, Moses fled from it. But look what happened. And the Lord said unto Moses, put forth thy hand and take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand and caught it and became a rod in his hand. You don't understand. The snake that Moses fled from, God said, Moses, pick the snake from the tail. God didn't tell him, pick it from the head. Friends, it is easier and safer to pick a snake from the head. I'm a biologist. We have tools. If you want to use tools to even pick up a snake, even if it's a python, if you can get it to hook on the next side, close to the head, you've gotten it. Just hold it down. Every other person starts to pick the other part down, you put it in the bag and you're gone. Couldn't say pick it from the head. God wanted to test Moses, if Moses was the vessel he could use, and to see how much Moses would trust him. Because there's going to be a time where Pharaoh and his chariot will be raging war behind, and there's going to be a rally scene in front. It's only one who have picked the tail of the snake by who have picked the snake by the tail that will stretch a rod. You don't understand what I'm saying? So if Moses can't trust God now, Moses can't walk with God. There's some little things God have been putting your way to see how much you could trust him. That he might take you to a greater glory and chapter of your life.
Hallelujah.
So God said, Moses, pick the snake by the tail. He said, Moses, who fled from him? You said it, God.
I believe.
I mean, you got my back. No problem. You just went straight and picked the tail. If you pick the tail of a snake, he has the whole thing to return back and hit on you. But Moses said, God said I should pick the snake by the tail. He went straight and picked it. God said, this is the one that can pass the Red Sea. This is the one that will put a rod on the water and return to blood. He won't doubt you. He won't doubt you. He won't doubt you. So, pass on your heads, please. Are you ready to pick the snake by the tail? What you're going through now might be just the tail of the snake God is expecting to hold. And it might take you to the next level of your destiny. I see greatness want to bring forth in the lives of people. But God is waiting for people that will trust him. Talk to him this morning and say, Lord, I want to trust you. Have mercy upon my unbelief. I want you to do exploit through me. I trust you, Lord. I trust you from today. I trust you concerning the life of those children. Maybe you have a child here, not performing as that child should perform. And you have in trouble, you get worried, you say, Lord, this is my child, this is how it will be. No! That child will be greater than you. Trust God with him. Say, trust God with her. Trust God with him right now. Trust God with that situation, that issue you are facing right now. Trust God with him. Say, Lord, I trust you. I trust you henceforth with this matter in my life. I trust you. If you say it's done, it's done. Oh, with you, there's no closed chapter. You are the God that has the last say. You control all things. You are the one that made all things. All things, you made all things. In you, all things consist. I feel strong in my spirit that they say, there's somebody, whether you are here right now, you are online, you are watching me, you have the challenge has to do with the way your child is performing, maybe academically or career is a concern to you. As I was talking, God said, Ben Carson that you are hearing about was the dullest man in his class, the present minister of housing under Donald Trump administration, who the world known as a renowned neuron surgeon. God said, I should tell you, I created his brain. I will redo that for your child. Trust me. Trust me. Trust me. Trust God with him. Trust God with her. Trust God with that situation in your life. Trust God concerning your life and your destiny. Ask God to give you the grace to trust him the more. Say, Father, grace to trust you the more. I trust you, Lord. I trust you. I don't look at the government. I don't look at the situation around me. I just trust you that this will be well. This will be done. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we are praying. We cover ourselves with the blood of Jesus. Lord, we appreciate you for your word that has come. Blessed be your holy name. We trust you with our future. We trust you concerning this country election. We trust you concerning our destiny. We trust you concerning our health. We see you in it. We know you love us. We know you desire the best for us. And we know you have control by every situation. Father, let us return back with testimony. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Workers, next Sunday is no more 9:30. Workers meeting 9 a.m. And church, our service starts 10 a.m. and we close 11:30, starting from next Sunday. Praise the Lord. But next Sunday also, we have a great event happening in the evening. It's going to be a wonderful one. Barbecue night. We're going to play games, table tennis, badminton, volleyball. That's next Sunday evening. We're going to be here, awesome here. Next Sunday evening, we'll have masks and order for you to come. Please, we'll do all the necessary precautions. You just come next Sunday and go and going to happen. Glorious things will happen.